DSLR or mirrorless? Which one do I choose? I'm going to tell you on today's episode of
Ask David Bergman.
Hey there, everybody. Welcome back. Here I am, as always, answering your photography questions. If you've got photo questions, you know what to do. You go to AskDavidBergman.com. Submit your question right there on that site. I just might pick it to answer right here on a future show. Today's question was sent in from Alicia C., and Alicia wants to know, if you had to choose one camera right now for concert photography, what would it be? Would you go with the Canon 1DX Mark III or the Canon R5? Thanks, Alicia, for sending in that question. I really appreciate it. What you're actually asking about is not necessarily the specific cameras, but whether I would shoot with a DSLR or a mirrorless camera. The 1DX Mark III is a DSLR, the R5 is a mirrorless. So you know what I'm going to do now? I'm going to talk about each system and explain what it is, why they're called that, and how they work, and then I'll get to my answer at the end. So what we're talking about here, this is a DSLR. This is the Canon 1DX Mark III, and what makes this a DSLR, it's a digital single lens reflex SLR cameras we've been shooting for many, many years with 35 millimeter film. It's a mature system, been around a long time. And when you take the picture, the light goes through the lens. There's no lens on here, but the light's going to go through the lens, and the film plane or the sensor is directly in the back of this camera here. And so the light's going to go through in a straight path and going to hit that sensor and expose your image. Now, to be able to look at your image before you shoot it, what has to happen is the viewfinder is up here. So you're looking up there, and there's a whole complex system of mirrors in here that's going to bounce that light around. So the mirror is at a 45 degree angle, and there's a couple other mirrors up on top, and the light goes in, it bounces all around, and you're looking at it straight through there. So you're actually looking at your subject, whatever you're shooting, you're looking at it optically. So you're looking at it in real life, just like if you were looking at a mirror in the bathroom at yourself, then you're just looking directly at yourself, right? So that light bounces around, and you can look at it off center here, and then take the picture, right? Now, when you take the picture, what happens is that mirror moves out of the way and blocks your view of that image just for a second, a millisecond, and then it gives you that straight path to expose the sensor in the back. That's going to be the highest quality when you have that direct path. Now, a mirrorless camera, on the other hand, does not have any of those mirrors. It's a mirrorless, right? It doesn't have that whole system. We've replaced that mirror box with an electronic viewfinder. So in the viewfinder here, there's basically a little TV monitor, and you're looking at the view through the lens. Now, the reason this is a relatively new technology is because those monitors, those little screens were not very good quality, and they've gotten so much better now that it's possible to use and have it be good enough quality to be able to see exactly what you're looking at so that you can take that picture. And then the viewfinder image is captured directly from the sensor. And so it's going to show you exactly what you're looking at before you take the picture. But you're not looking at it optically. You're looking at a TV screen inside that viewfinder. It's called an EVF electronic viewfinder. Now, both types of cameras have also an LED screen on the back. On the DSLR, it's usually called live view shooting when you use that. Personally, I don't like to use that because I don't like to shoot with the camera out in front of me like that. I prefer to get the viewfinder right up to my eye, and that's really how I prefer to shoot. So I don't really use that LED as my viewfinder, but it is available on some DSLRs, on many DSLRs. So now these two types of cameras, DSLR and mirrorless, they are similar in some ways. Many, many ways they're similar. Both of them can have interchangeable lenses. That really has nothing to do with whether there's a mirror or not. If you're using a system that you can change the lenses. Some of them have lenses built in, single lenses that you can't change. Many of them, you can change lenses. They make them entry-level bodies. They make advanced bodies. They make them full frame or crop sensor. The mirror, whether it has a mirror or not, has no effect really on image quality. There are other things in the camera that affect that. So a lot of the things in these two cameras are very, very similar. But there are some significant differences. First, let's talk about autofocus. The DSLR has a separate autofocus sensor and a separate processor in the camera. It's actually sort of below the mirror box. It's in that mirror box there that reads it to use for the autofocus, whereas the mirrorless actually calculates autofocus directly on the sensor. It does not have a separate sensor to calculate autofocus. Also, as far as size and weight of these two cameras, since the mirror box and the other components are removed from a mirrorless, comparable mirrorless bodies are going to be smaller and lighter than their counterpart DSLR. This is really more noticeable in entry-level cameras, something like this. This is the Canon EOS M50. This is a very small mirrorless camera. It's going to be much more noticeable in something like this, where size is important for people to carry around. An entry-level camera is the kind of camera you could stick this in your pocket, take this on vacation. It's really easy. Correct me if I'm wrong in the comments, but I'm pretty sure there's no DSLR camera that is this small. This is a tiny little camera, and it's really, really great image quality. So this is something I would carry around on vacation. The professional bodies and lenses really have more features, and while they're definitely smaller and lighter than their counterparts, the mirrorless bodies are not going to be small or light, right? So they're really made for the highest quality possible and not made to be something you can just stick in your pocket. Something like this R5, I've added the grip to it. I actually like having some heft on these cameras, so I've added the grip. I'm not going to put a 600mm f4 and shoot sports with this M50. You could, but I'm going to use something like the R5 or the 1DX Mark III. So I'm not buying them because of size or weight, but just something to be aware of. The comparable bodies are going to be a little bit smaller. As far as optical versus using an electronic viewfinder, with a DSLR, like I said, you're looking directly at your subject optically, like in real life. It feels more natural. I think it's more human. It feels a little more natural. It's much more responsive because you're looking at the person. Even though you've got a camera in front of your face, you're seeing the real world just as if you didn't have a camera in front of your face. The electronic viewfinder, it is nice because what you see is what you get for your exposure. So even though you're looking at a TV monitor and not looking at the real world, you can see if you change your exposure, like when you're first learning how to shoot and you're changing your exposure, you can actually see it get brighter and darker. There are really no surprises when you're shooting with a mirrorless like that. Now, of course, you could use that LED screen on a DSLR to do that if you wanted to use that to check your exposure. But again, I don't really like to shoot like that, so it's not going to be so much of an option for me with that camera. I mentioned autofocus briefly. Of course, autofocus is so important when you have subjects that are moving, which is almost everything. The way the DSLR autofocus system works, it's in most cameras, especially the high-end cameras, it uses predictive autofocus. So it's a separate processor that is in the camera for autofocus. And it really, what it does is it kind of guesses where a moving subject is going to be by the time it takes the picture, because when you push that button down, it takes a second, not a second, it takes like a millisecond or whatever it is for that mirror to flip up and the shutter curtain to open to expose the sensor. So that time that it takes, your subject may have moved. If you're shooting a race car coming at you at 150 miles an hour, it will have moved by the time that opens. But this technology is so good in these high-end DSLRs now that the processor is watching what's happening, and it sees the subject getting closer, and it can gauge the speed. And when that mirror flips up, even though that mirror flipping up blocks the autofocus sensor, and it even blocks your eye, right? You can't see through there while that mirror is flipped up. That's why there's blackout. When that happens, the processor in the autofocus actually guesses where the subject is going to be by the time the picture is taken. And it does a really good job. This is a mature technology. I used to shoot for Sports Illustrated a lot. I've done Olympics and Super Bowls and World Series with these types of cameras. And I've never had trouble, especially in the last decade or so, with these mature autofocus systems. One downside of that DSLR autofocus system, it only covers a smaller portion of the frame. It doesn't cover the entire frame, but as long as your subject is in that part of the frame, that center part of the frame, then you're going to be good to go. Now, mirrorless, brand new technology, right? The autofocus basically reads off the sensor in real time. There's no mirror to move out of the way, so the camera doesn't have to do any guessing. It can just take the picture and autofocus at the same time. It can walk and chew gum at the same time. With Canon, they use the latest digital dual pixel AF system, and it's really, really good. When you add in the newest technology like eye, head, face, body detection, and there are new algorithms to pick out people, animals, and even cars, and then you have full autofocus coverage across the entire frame, which is really, really nice. It's definitely a more advanced system than the tried and true DSLR system. So again, nothing wrong with the DSLR system, but the newest tech is definitely coming in the mirrorless bodies. Let's talk about lenses for a second. With DSLRs, this Canon uses what's called EF lenses, EF mount lenses. There are so many to choose from. It's been around a very long time. I would say, I don't know the number, there's at least 100, maybe there are more than 100 EF lenses to choose from. Now, the thing is, you can use those older lenses, the EF lenses, even the new EF lenses, on an R body, a mirrorless body, you have to just get an adapter. Canon makes a $100 adapter. They make a few others, but there's a simple $100 adapter. So you can use those lenses on the newest bodies, the mirrorless bodies, without any loss in quality or speed or anything like that. The new RF lenses, the lenses that are made just for the R bodies that don't work on the EF, on the DSLR bodies with the EF mount, they can do things now that lenses have never been able to do before. Canon makes a 2870 f2.0 lens. There's never been a zoom with an f2 maximum aperture in that range, 2870. I'm using that lens right here to shoot this video, and I'm at 28 millimeters at f2. This background behind me is probably 3 feet back, but because I'm at f2, it's even more out of focus than it normally would be, and it looks nice and creamy. So I love that lens. That lens has never existed before for a DSLR. So that's the newest, latest, and greatest tech. There are new lenses coming out all the time, new RF lenses. Canon just actually announced a dual 5.2 millimeter RF lens. Basically, there are two lenses, like your eyes, on this one. It's one lens, but with two lenses on it. And it's kind of like our eyes, where it's used to shoot immersive 3D stills and video. Here's a sidebar question. Do you guys have a VR headset? I personally have the Oculus Quest 2, and I absolutely love it. It's super fun for games, and watching 3D video is amazing. Like, movies and stuff are incredible in 3D video. But you can also watch 3D video using inexpensive cardboard adapters for your phone. I'm actually considering offering some of these videos, my Ask David Bergman videos, in 3D down the road once I get my hands on this new lens. If I'm on location, for example, and I'm, let's say, with Erica in Central Park, and I was shooting 3D, is that something you would watch? Instead of only seeing what I'm, you know, deciding that you should look at, when I show a shot of the light, or I show a shot of the model or whatever, you can only look at that normally. But if you could be there in the environment in 3D and look around at 180 degrees and see the whole scene, is that something you would watch? Would you be interested in that? Let me know in the comments down below, because this is something that I'm considering as soon as I can get that lens. Anyway, that new lens is only possible because of the advancements in mirrorless cameras and technology. All right, let's get back to our comparisons. A couple more things. If you're shooting video, on a DSLR, you have to use that LED screen on the back, because obviously you can't monitor video output through an optical viewfinder. On a mirrorless, you could use the LED, or you can use the EVF and really get your eye up to it. It's kind of nice to have that option if you want to get your eye right up there in bright sunlight and really block out some of that sun, for example. The truth is, most people shooting video are either going to use the LED, because that is something that you would normally hold it out in front of you, or if you're in a more professional setup, you're going to probably use an external monitor anyway. So I don't know that that's so much of an issue. As far as battery life, mirrorless cameras are generally smaller than their comparable DSLRs, as we said. So that means the battery is probably also going to be smaller, which could be a detriment if you're out on a long shoot. You just might need to bring extra batteries. You have to buy extra batteries and have them with you to get the same amount of shots that you would get from a DSLR. And then as far as price, there are many more DSLRs to choose from. There are more entry-level options, so that means price has traditionally been lower on a DSLR. Mirrorless is the latest tech, and there are still fewer of them out there, but there are more coming out all the time. So price is really getting to the same place as the DSLRs. For the top-of-the-line bodies like these, the prices are really about the same for comparable gear. Now, Alicia, you asked about choosing one camera for concert photography. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what I'm using and where I think this is all going. I actually did a video a few months ago spelling out every camera and lens that I'm traveling with on my current concert tour. I'll put a link to that below. But the short version is, I'm mostly using optical cameras as my primary handheld bodies. That's this, the Canon EOS 1DX Mark III. This thing is a beast. The batteries are gonna last forever, and it's built like a tank. I also like seeing my subject optically, because I've shot that way for decades, literally since I first started taking pictures, as opposed to looking at a screen. That takes a little getting used to if you've been shooting a certain way for a long time. I do use the mirrorless Canon R5, which is currently the top of the line full frame mirrorless from Canon. I use it as one of my remote cameras. That eye, face, head, body detection, along with the autofocus that covers the full frame, really makes it an insanely perfect camera for a remote, because it's gonna pick up my subject a lot quicker and stay on them, rather than just having that center of the frame as my focus area. These cameras, they travel the world with me, and I shoot thousands of images every single night. So build quality is important to me. Canon doesn't currently have a body that has the build quality of the 1DX Mark III with the weather sealing and all of that. However, As I'm shooting this in October of 2021, they have announced, you probably know, the new EOS R3, and I do hope to have a couple of those before the end of the year. From what I've seen, they're a similar form factor to the 1DX Mark III, plus add in all the latest advances in tech like eye tracking for autofocus and crazy fast burst speeds, 30 frames a second. I can't wait to get my hands on them. I hope, Canon, if you're listening, please send me a couple of those. I'm dying to use those things. Hopefully I'll have them by the end of the year. And I gotta tell you, they probably are going to replace my 1DX Mark III bodies. If I was just starting today, I would definitely be all in on mirrorless, no question. It's the latest and greatest tech, and it seems to be advancing every single day. New lenses are always coming out and are really pushing the envelope of what can be done. The truth is, you really can't go wrong with either a DSLR or a mirrorless body. At the end of the day, what do you use? You use your eyes, your brain, and your heart to make pictures. Just make sure that your cameras can keep up and help you capture what you're already imagining. So thanks, Alicia, for sending that in. I hope that helps. Remember, if you guys have your own photo questions, go to AskDavidBergman.com. Comment down below. Let me know. Are you shooting mirrorless? Are you shooting DSLR? Why do you choose one over the other? I'm really curious where everybody is shooting these days and how that's working out. If you're not already a subscriber to the Adorama TV YouTube channel, go ahead and click that button down below. Use the little bell icon. You'll be notified as soon as new photo shows come out all week long. And of course, I'm back here every Monday, 10 a.m. Eastern, with a brand new episode. I hope to see you back here next week. I'll have a new question right here on Ask David Bergman.